Instead, we find ourselves at the foot of Elgar's beautiful Malvern Hill. It's a little mist-shrouded today, I'm afraid, to visit one of the very few independent survivors of Britain's generally ailing motor industry. We've brought our outside broadcast cameras to Worcestershire to show you a heartening and 65-year-old motoring success story. Morgan is not only alive and well, but can now claim to be one of the oldest privately owned companies on the British motoring scene. Founded by H.F.S. Morgan, who built his first cycle car in 1909 in the nearby Malvern College School workshops, Morgan have occupied these same traditional, almost unique factory premises since the 20s. The Mark made its name, of course, by making some 40,000 three-wheelers like this one. At one time, even turning out over 2,500 in a year. However, the increased sophistication of the four-wheeled Austin 7 had its effect, and Morgan added their fourth wheel from 1937 onwards. Today, the over 100-strong workforce, a high proportion of them craftsmen, from metal workers to carpenters, fashion just 10 cars in a good week. Yet today, unlike many other British car firms, the Morgan waiting list is over 2 years long. At the helm of what has always been very much a family affair, HFS's son Peter Morgan. Peter, your firm owes its very existence to the three-wheeler, and yet you don't make them today. Why is that?
I think it's a question of price of the car. It would be an expensive car to build it in the same manner that it was pre-war and just after the war, and probably was summed up by my father making a remark about the rare transmission, insofar as the chain bevel box fitted to the Morgan is rather more expensive than a quantity produced rear axle.
How many four-wheel cars have you made since 36, 37?
Four-wheel cars somewhere in the region, I would say, of about 20,000.
So you've never really caught up on those incredible numbers that you produce with the three-wheel cars?
No. The mid-20s were the largest production time.
And it's always been a sports car. Have you never been tempted into the family saloon field?
Oh, I think that's undoubtedly historical. Mm. The three-wheeler, you see, not only was it an economy car, it was also quite a sporting car. And, you know, it could show the way up hills to quite a lot of four-wheelers of that time. And that is the theme. Also, I think one has to remember that a manufacturer does get known for a certain type of car. And to deviate from this is somewhat hazardous. And I think very much we are known as a sports car.
I know your father was a great motor sportsman, indeed. You are as well. What would you say were the milestones in Morgan's history as far as the sports field was concerned?
Well, there were very many successes with the three-wheelers throughout the whole time up to the last war. And then, of course, just before that, the four-wheeler was brought out in 1936. And that was run at Le Mans and did quite well. It won the Rudge Whitworth Cup at that time, the pre-war Le Mans. And then after the war, I suppose the best performance was put up by Christopher Lawrence, who went to Le Mans in 1962 and won the 2-litre class. And he drove his car there and he drove it back after the event.
He drove there, won the race, and then drove back afterwards. What do you see the future of sports cars as being? I mean, you've made the first real sports car. Do you think you're making the last?
Well, we sometimes in our adverts we say the first and the last of the real sports cars. But I'm optimistic, I think, two grounds. One is that there are other open cars being built. I think a small number of people will continue to want open cars. And I suppose I could sum it up that why can't you have an open car? I mean, surely you have motorcycles, right. You know.
What are the two models that you make here at Malvern?
The models are the Plus 8, which is fitted with the Rover V8 engine, and then the Morgan 44 1600 with the Ford pushrod engine.
Well, we'd rather like to take a look at those being made now, if we may. So let's start off with the chassis, which is still retained here at Morgan, and here's Tony Bastable.
The Morgan starts life here as a pile of bits on the floor in the chassis shop. And the chassis itself, which is not actually made by Morgans, but made for them, by an outside contractor. It's a very substantial job of work indeed. It's a long ladder chassis, very tough, made out of Z-section steel, and on that they begin to hang the suspension. At the back, a very live and lively rear axle, leaf springs, and here lever arm dampers. But it's up the front when the suspension gets really interesting because, believe it or not, the Morgan still uses a suspension system which was designed and patented by H.F.S. Morgan in the year 1910. And it is, as they say, adequate. And not just adequate, but very efficient. This coil spring here is covering up a vertical pillar of steel to which the stub axle down there is attached. This is what it looks like. Here's that steel pillar there. Of course, it's restrained at top and bottom, otherwise the whole thing would fall apart. Here's the stub axle. My hand is the wheel. It works just like that. Very simple, straightforward system, and very efficient. Now, the springing is done, of course, by the coil spring, and here we have a telescopic shock absorber to absorb the shocks. So despite the fact that the system was designed long enough ago to earn its place in any history of motoring technology, there is absolutely nothing old-fashioned about its performance. Brakes, too, well up to the minute. The latest thing, discs at the front, drums at the rear. And also in this shop, the wheels are put on. Now, what kind of wheels you get depends on what kind of model you've ordered. The Plus 8 comes with magnesium alloy wheels, the 4-4 with either pressed steel wheels, or there is an option of spoked wire wheels. And of course, the wheels have to be put on here in this shop, because Morgan's don't have a through-flow production line. And therefore, the only way to get this from here to its next port of call, which is where the body is put on, is to wheel it there.
A separate chassis and still a separate body too. That's the Morgan method. The bodywork steel, fashioned entirely here on the premises, is fitted around a wooden frame. Now, in charge not only of the car's development, but also the production side, is Maurice Owen. Maurice, what sort of wood do you use for the frame?
Ash, mainly.
Why ash?
Because it is strong, very durable, and it has a memory.
What do you mean, memory?
Well, when we make a frame up, our chassis frames tend to twist and whip a little bit, but it always remembers where it was and comes back to it.
Is it literally a glue and screw job? Just
yes,
like that?
Certainly, just glue and screw.
I must confess, I've noticed a few joints that I seem to remember from my days in the wood workshop at school.
Yes, practically every joint there is, I think, is used somewhere in the bodywork.
So
yes.
You've got to have skilled carpenters around.
Oh, yes, certainly.
Where do you get your ash from these days?
Mainly comes from Belgium. It's kiln-dried. And we hold a fair amount of stock that it's probably in stock here for about 18 months before we actually use it.
So what parts of the car are metal? Steel, in other words?
The panels of the body are all in steel. This is not necessarily all in steel. We do make some in aluminium.
Oh, yeah.
As some of our buyers are competition-minded, and they like them in aluminium because they're a little bit lighter.
Oh, I get you. And I suppose corrosion is a thing,
corrosion
too, keep in mind with
also,
aluminium.
Yes, it does.
But most of your cars are in steel, and yet I haven't seen any great presses around here. So are they being shaped?
No, we don't use any presses at all. Everything is hand-shaped or rolled. And the front wings are fabricated from about 6 pieces, which are rolled and welded together. And about another 8 panels for the complete body.
So it really is the hand-built car.
Oh, yes, very much so.
But with skilled carpenters and skilled steel workers and other metals as well, isn't it difficult to find the right sort of people?
Oh, it is. It's difficult to find the right type of people that can fit in with our methods. But we prefer, really, to train our own with our own apprentices.
I must say, chatting the lads here, it seems that quite a few have spent quite a few years with the company.
Oh, yes, they have.
So it's obviously a very happy workshop.
Oh, I think so, yes. We like
Maurice,
to feel so.
Thank you very much indeed for showing me around.
Thank you.
Thank you. Once framed and panelled, the car is wheeled round to the painting shed, where it's sprayed, by hand, of course, and then both the wiring and the hydraulics are added.
This is the trim shop. Here they make and fit the limited number of creature comforts that sit atop the Morgan's wooden floorboards. And yes, before you ask, you can have your Morgan trimmed in leather for an extra £50. Like the other shops, it's staffed by many men and women who have worked here since the day they left school.
In a big car factory, you're on a conveyor belt and doing the same job all day, every day. Whereas this one, I'm on a two-seater back now. I could be on four-seater backs, recliners, plus eights, four-seater front seats, glove boxes, cowls. I could just change it all day. I'm never on the same job all day.
Well, you show your job. There's always a job here for us, and nobody's pushing you to do the work. You get satisfaction, you see all the models, all the end product, and he's a good gaffer to work for.
The one thing about it, you feel secure here, you feel as though your job's there. You know, Well, it's just I've been here since I left school and I'm quite satisfied with the job.
I've never really worked in a large factory, so I don't know the difference between this and a large factory. It's very interesting, because each car is individual. It's, you know, meet lots of people, interesting people. And you can see what you're doing, you know, sort of see the finishing thing, you know.
Most cars are different in some way. You know, some cars are up to fairly standard, and then you get another one with a lot of extras. I've been here, twice now. I left school, came here, worked here for about 4.5 years, left, went to the building trade, then came back here in 69. I've been here ever since.
A lineup of Morgans ready for the road, and Derek Day in charge of sales. Derek, how long does it take from the chassis stage to reach this stage?
Some 6 to 8 weeks.
Do you find that you've been squeezed out of the American market at all with their rather strict regulations?
Well, in fact, we haven't exported to the States since 1970 due to the present safety and clean air.
Oh, yeah.
Consequently, we now export to other markets. For instance, this one now goes to the Republic of Ireland, This one to France, one over there goes to Germany.
What sort of export market have you got? I mean, what's the percentage?
Some 55%.
55?
Yes.
That's really some going, isn't it? Yes. What's the price now of the two basic cars?
The 4-4 two-seater, 2392, the four-seater, 2597, and the plus 8 with the row of the 8 engine, 3375.
What about the waiting list?
It's in excess of 2 years.
2 years?
Indeed.
Any chance of it diminishing? Does it look as though it's going down at all?
Fortunately, one sees no likelihood of that.
So it's still a 2-year waiting list.
Yes.
Well, good luck to you
Thank
in
you.
The future.